Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Woman They Wanted, Shattering the Illusion of the Good Christian Wife by Shannon Harris, narrated by Shannon Harris. The most destructive cultural conditions for a woman to be born into and to live under are those that insist on obedience without consultation with one's soul, those with no loving forgiveness rituals, those that force a woman to choose between soul and society, those where compassion for others is walled off by economic tiers or caste systems, where the body is seen as something needing to be cleaned or as a shrine to be regulated by fiat, where the new, the unusual, or the different engenders no delight, and where curiosity and creativity are punished and denigrated instead of rewarded, or only rewarded if one is not a woman, where painful acts are perpetrated on the body and called holy, or whenever a woman is punished unjustly, as Alice Miller puts it succinctly, for her own good, where the soul is not recognized as being its own right. Clarissa Pinkola Estes, PhD. To my parents, Mitzi Ash and Milt Hendrickson. Preface. I've learned the hard way that fear is a miserable cage, and though it is an invisible one, its bars can feel as strong as iron. I know this because I spent a decade or more of my life afraid. Whether you are afraid of something inside of you or outside of you, the way out is the same, and that is directly through it. That is easier said than done, but it is how you will find your courage. No one can give you courage, not really. You enter courage, and then you collect it. You'll see what I mean someday. But it is worth it, getting braver. I wasn't always afraid. I was a bold and spunky child. I loved to stand on the beach where the waves broke. The more threatening the wave, the better. I loved the thrill of it. No matter how massive they loomed over my pint-sized frame, I knew I could make myself a nimble arrow, dive through the center, and reemerge victorious on the other side. I was convinced I was stronger than the waves, and in a way I was, because I knew how the waves thought and how they behaved, and I knew my way through them. But then again, I had been prepared for it. My father was a swimmer, and the water had always been a part of my life. My earliest memories of conquering fear were being coaxed off a diving board with my dad treading below, promising to catch me, or being perched atop his back while he swam us so far out in the ocean I was certain we'd be lunch for a shark. But my father, with his cool natural confidence, would chuckle as if to say, "Nothing to fear here, I've got you." He always made me feel safe. I think it is easier to navigate a world that we know, a familiar environment with familiar people, but the unknown world alone? How does a person, particularly a woman, prepare for that? A church world for which she has no context or history? Dorothy was not at ease in Oz until she got to the end of the Yellow Brick Road. Princess Diana took years to find her way out of the British monarchy. Alice was out of sorts in Wonderland until she found the key. It takes time to find the way. Every day, countless people enter into a new life-changing situation, a job, a relationship, motherhood, an unexpected move to a new country. We sometimes go in thinking it will be one thing, only to discover it is really quite another. There is little time to prepare for the force of this kind of change, little chance to work out your choices or prevent the upending of life as you once knew it. From the moment of our arrival in this new situation, it feels as though we might sink or swim. This was me in a world I knew as church. As a 23-year-old singer-performer and soon-to-be wife of an internationally known author and megachurch pastor, nothing in my past experience could possibly have prepared me for what was to come. It was a wave that caught me completely off guard, sending me topsy-turvy and tumbling. It was not until years later, when I finally managed to find the shore, that I grasped the whole of what had happened, like the groggy coming to from a drug-induced dream. It was a mistake so innocent and common, it is almost laughable now. A young woman so captivated by her desire for someone or something that she trades her soul to get it, only to realize later at what cost to herself. I became the woman the church leaders wanted, betraying myself in the process, until I was a fragment of the woman I knew myself to be. Imagine my surprise when I happened upon stories of women with experiences similar to mine. Women like me who had struggled to disentangle themselves from patriarchy, or had experienced a profound awakening or a metamorphosis from one self to another. I discovered these stories in books that became companions on my journey to reclaim my true self. The wisdom of these authors, along with a few trusted confidants, validated my experiences and at times gave me names to put to feelings and ideas for which I had no vocabulary. I've come to learn that my church experience is sadly representative of many others' experience. The criticism I present of my own church does not mean I condemn all churches, Christianity in general, or other religions. Suffice it to say, Christianity spans a wide range of beliefs and practices and cultural and political differences. It's not surprising that under the mantle of Christianity, there are multitudes of true believers in conflict with other true believers. The history of Christianity is one of divisions and schisms, competing doctrines and controversy, and those claiming to be true Christians. Christianity is and likely always will be in the eye of the beholder. As a layperson, but seasoned pastor's wife of 15 years, who has played many roles, I have sought to avoid confusing my experience at my church with hasty generalizations about Christianity. Forgive me when I fail to heed humorist Mark Twain's observation, "All generalizations are false," including this one. This book is the result of my journey, the story of a young woman who makes a series of choices that gradually change her into someone she doesn't know. It is not a book about religion so much as it is a woman's story, my story within a church and within patriarchy. Most importantly, it is a book about protecting the vital connection we each need to have to ourselves, our values, and our dreams. It is my hope that the book will inspire women and other listeners to live more courageously and authentically wherever they are. Part 1. Beginnings. Starving. It was a Sunday morning after breakfast, and my husband was preaching in a few hours. My three children were somewhere in our 4,000-square-foot colonial in the suburbs. My husband was the pastor of a large, conservative, American evangelical church, and I was his wife. At this point, we had been on staff at the church for nearly 15 years. And when I say we, what I really mean is he. I was not on staff. My husband was on staff. Only men were pastors there. But for some reason, every move I made mattered, as if his job depended on it. That is the way it always was. But I did not get paid for all this mattering. I had not minded that before, but I was starting to. It was not so much about the money, though the money would have been nice. It was more about the mattering. My husband, Joshua, was the hip young guy hired to carry the church through the next generation. He was the head pastor now, and our church was the mothership church in a growing network of churches. We were reformed, charismatic. It was a whole brand. On this particular Sunday, I was having a breakdown. Or more like, I was sending out an SOS. You should know that up until this point in my life, my church life, that is, I had been mostly unconscious. Not literally, but figuratively. I didn't know you could be unconscious and at the same time think you were living your life, but you can. But my depression was changing that. It was forcing me to pay attention to myself, and it was only getting worse. I was crying all the time and hiding it from my friends. I had to figure out what the cause was before I ruined everything. My three kids needed me. I wondered if I was going crazy because I kept seeing the same exact scene in my mind. Months would go by and I'd forget about it, but the scene always returned. It was me, but instead of me, I was a gnarly, hungry old beggar woman in a burlap dress with long, frizzy hair. The beggar woman was crawling on the floor searching for crumbs. Whenever she found one, she pulled it close to her chest and looked over her shoulder anxiously, worried that someone might steal it from her. A few years from that day, I would know exactly why I was having this vision. I lost myself trying to be good for other people. I was trying to be the woman they wanted. I was happy to do it at one time, but not anymore. I had nothing left to give. The crumbs were the last little bits of me I was trying to hold on to. I was starving for my life. That Sunday, I called to my husband, who was downstairs preparing his sermon in his office, which was next to the great room. The great room was where we hosted our 20-some pastors and their wives about once a month. I asked my husband to come up to my bedroom because I had something important to tell him. I met him at the door. I was trying to make a scene, but a quiet one, because I didn't want to alarm the kids. They were 12, 10, and 6. I said I wasn't going to church that day, that I needed him to take the kids, and that I was locking myself in our bedroom and wasn't coming out for 3 whole days. And I said I wasn't sure I could keep going to church anymore. At that, his eyes widened for a second. I could see the wheels turning in his head, but not much ever rattled my husband. He was the oldest of 7 children, and I often said he was the best mother in the house. He looked at me and said, "Okay," and then turned to head downstairs to handle the fray. It wasn't exactly the response I was hoping for. I shut the bedroom door and took my computer from the dresser where I'd left it. I walked over to my bed, slid my hand underneath the mattress, and took out the book on Catholicism I had hidden there. Then I settled onto the bed to look for answers. My mother knew the place was trouble from the very start. On her very first visit to church, I was giving my testimony. That's where I stood up to tell everyone my story of how I'd come to believe in God and why I was now a changed person forever. The pastors of the church had asked me to share my story on a Sunday morning for the service, and I had invited both of my parents to attend. It was maybe a year after I started coming to church. During my testimony, I talked about how my parents' divorce had been difficult for me and how I'd been able to make peace with it. After I spoke and the sermon was over, CJ, the head pastor, invited those in the congregation whose lives had been affected by divorce to come forward to receive ministry. Often this just meant prayer, but sometimes, like that day, it meant Bob. Bob was the music pastor and an extraordinary pianist and musician. Earlier in his career, he had created and developed a highly successful Christian music group. Bob was CJ's other half, and, in my opinion, a huge reason for the success of the ministry. Many churches have a charismatic leader, but they also need to have heart. They need vulnerability. Bob could make a room of 10,000 people feel intimate and personal. CJ may have been the one to first attract people, but it was Bob who kept them there. Bob had a special gift for making up songs spontaneously in real time with no advance preparation. The church called them prophetic songs. They were complete with story, meaning, melody, and rhyme. Bob would sing them in the first person as if it were God speaking. There was something magical, emotional, and powerful about these songs. If the intent was to get an emotional response from people, it worked, and CJ seemed to take full advantage of this. If he wanted a prophetic song after a sermon, all he had to do was cue Bob with a look from across the stage to order it. On the day I was giving my testimony, CJ did want one. And as I mentioned, those who had been affected by divorce had gathered at the front of the stage. Bob started to play the piano while collecting his thoughts, and then he began to sing. It didn't take long before half of us were crying. Someone handed me a tissue. When the song was finished, we all went back to our seats, wrecked for God. When the service ended, we walked out to the lobby, and to my surprise, my mother turned and placed herself squarely in front of me. She was abrupt and sharp with a warning, which was out of the ordinary for her. She isn't one to interfere. But she wanted me to hear that she didn't trust the church. She thought it was disingenuous and manipulative. I brushed her off and came to Bob and CJ's defense, and then we went out for lunch. And for the next 2 decades, my mother never said another word. My mother has never been wrong. Not yet, anyway. Downstairs, I heard a new voice in the kitchen. It was Bev, a woman from the church who babysat for us on occasion. Josh must have called her to help with the kids. God bless her. A few minutes later, I heard the side door shut and the house went quiet. I was alone now. I Googled the 5 points of Calvinism, half thinking maybe I should just change religions. Church had started out so positive, or so I thought, but over the years, our church doctrine had veered more and more Calvinist, and in my opinion, it hadn't been good for anyone. The Puritans were Calvinists, and they sure didn't seem happy. Maybe that was the problem. Calvinism's essential teaching is called total depravity, which teaches that people are corrupt to the core. Even the good that comes from a person is said to be God acting from within them and not the actual person. It was a very depressing way to live. It meant that even if you did something nice for someone, like buying them a latte, you had to be sure to remind yourself that it wasn't your idea. Good job, Shannon! Just don't forget the latte was God's idea and not yours, because nothing good comes from you, okay? It's because of Calvinism that I now pay my therapist hundreds of dollars to remind me that I'm fabulous. To be fair, not everything was terrible at church. There was a lot of good, too, like the people. So many good people. The all-in types. I was half-seriously considering becoming a Catholic. My grandmother was Catholic, so there was a family history there. They also had tangibles like beads and candles, things you could actually touch, which sounded nice for some reason. Frankly, our pastors didn't consider Catholics real Christians. They said the Catholics placed too much importance on Mary. I wasn't sure I cared what our pastors thought anymore. The theologians in our camp had the right answers to everything. Everything. Actually, they had been right about too many things for too many years. It started to give them away because everybody knows no one can be that right all of the time. If they had at least thrown in a few I don't knows in the mix, maybe I would have gone on for another decade. But no one else was doing Christianity right enough or hard enough or biblical enough, and their unquestionable certainty had grown tiresome. I wasn't just skeptical, I was tired. I was really, really, really tired. Church. There are churches, and then there are circuses. CJ, whose official name is Charles Joseph Mahaney, was a young 20-something when he founded the church along with Larry Tomczak, a man about 10 years his senior. CJ was a self-professed former pothead who hadn't bothered to finish college. The two met sometime during the hippie Jesus movement. By 1982, they weren't just building a church. They were building a denomination and a name for themselves, a movement, a brand. It started as a small, tight-knit group of young adults in the Washington, D.C. area meeting in somebody's home, just a bunch of young people casually getting together for fellowship and prayer. But then those young adults married each other and became young families. And young families attracted more young families. And soon, they were a growing church. They moved the Sunday services out of the living room and into school auditoriums. Eventually, they saved enough money to buy some land in the suburbs and build. They called it Covenant Life Church. In simplest terms, the church was evangelical, think Billy Graham, and charismatic, think faith healings and people falling over, and reformed, think Puritans, who, you may recall, hung a bunch of women most likely for getting sick from a fungus in the rye. The charismatic part was the emotion. The reformed part was the tradition. And then there was female submission. As the church grew, so did the vision of its leaders. They added a publishing branch and a music branch. CJ started the pastor's college and began training and sending out men to plant churches. Bob trained men to be music leaders. All the while, Covenant Life Church remained the blueprint and model for all the other churches in the ministry to follow. They called it People of Destiny International, which definitely sounded strange to me at first, but the people were so very nice and normal, I got used to it. When I heard they were planning on changing the name, I assumed it was because they wanted something sensible, but it may have been to escape the past or get a fresh start. Eventually, the name was changed to Sovereign Grace Ministries. At that time, there were roughly 80 churches across the country under the Sovereign Grace umbrella. I don't think the church intended to become as unhealthy as it did. It appears to have gradually and quietly headed in that direction. As the church grew, so did CJ's power within it. He began lording over his flock. He used his position and power to serve his own needs and not the needs of his congregation. He surrounded himself with younger men who idolized him, and he trained them as leaders. He asked that they protect him from scrutiny, and he was quick to cut off relationships with those who did not show him the loyalty and admiration he felt he deserved. And most significant was what I would come to learn later. CJ's misconduct would become public through some 600 pages of evidence compiled by a former associate titled The Documents. In the months that followed, CJ's leadership was again, as it still is, noticeably absent in matters pertaining to allegations of sexual abuse cover-up that would have occurred during his time of leadership. This was a leader who rose to his position because he was charismatic and could hold the attention of a crowd. I'm not aware that he had any qualifications beyond that. He did not attend seminary or divinity school, but somehow he ended up in the role of a shepherd when he might have been better suited for a career as a used car salesman or an actor. Did he even believe in God? Who really knows? If you think about it, being a pastor celebrity is a pretty sweet job. People give you 10% of their income, and you hardly have to ask. You get a lot of attention, but the job is far more stable than an acting career. Besides, you can put on an act anytime you want. You can pretend to care and love others. Whatever the case, in reflecting on the entirety of my experience at Covenant Life Church, no other single individual's ideas and behavior bring more clarity or understanding to the broader context of the stories I share in this audiobook. CJ. My mother says that the first time I introduced her to CJ, which we think was at my wedding, he didn't look into her eyes. She never forgot that. For me now, CJ lives in my mind as a caricature of himself. He's on stage wearing black coattails and a top hat, looking out with a sly smile as he performs his tricks. He is the ringmaster, the salesman, the magician. He quickly builds a house out of cards and whoosh, it's back in his hand again as a full deck. Look, now he's making something new. We are all mesmerized and our eyes are fixed on his waving and shouting and antics. The show moves on at a steady clip, so there's no time to process. His stories keep us laughing or crying, but most of all, they keep our eyes glued on him. We are too busy being entertained and hoping for a chance to participate in the fun to realize that we are growing old. I believed him back then, on the stage, and I believed he believed the words he preached. Off the stage, though, I was seeing things more accurately. He was different on the ground, distant. He looked through me whenever we spoke, and I could tell that he didn't truly see me. His smile went no deeper than the curve of his lips. After one particular Sunday service, people came forward for prayer. Leaders were already positioned along the perimeter of the stage, ready to greet them and pray. CJ was standing on the stage, of course, which was nearly 5 feet high, and he was towering over everyone below. I was standing just a few feet behind him because I had sung that morning. I got caught up watching him as he matched up people wanting prayer with people available for prayer. He was reaching down towards people's heads and swooshing people together using large arm gestures to accomplish this. He was very focused on this work, and I wondered why he felt the need to do that. Surely grown adults could manage to get a prayer without assistance from him above. I couldn't help but wonder if he was avoiding praying for people. Of all the people who should be on the ground praying, shouldn't it be the pastor of the church? When I began singing for the church, CJ started introducing me before my solos. He would make a big deal of it and call me the girl who gave up her dreams for the local church. I don't remember ever stating that as a fact. I even visited Nashville during this time to sing for someone in the music industry, thanks to a connection I had made at church. But most people discouraged me from moving and pursuing acting and singing. Music careers were worldly, and Hollywood was overflowing with sin and debauchery. And anyway, women were supposed to get married and have children. There had been a lot of pressure to give up my dreams. That pressure just floated in the air. Air pressure. Because CJ was introducing me this way, people in the church were constantly praising me. They would say how wonderful it was of me to give up my dreams for the local church, which felt good. Later, I would realize that by calling me that, CJ actually called that reality into being. He was naming me. CJ named other things besides people. He had phrases that he used often for dramatic effect. He called the church the dearest place on earth. He called the church bookstore the world's greatest bookstore. When someone asked CJ how he was, his standard reply was, "Better than I deserve." It's a powerful thing, naming someone, giving a newborn baby a name that they will use for the rest of their life. The name will shape the child's life forever. But creating a name to shape someone's identity, it's even more powerful. It is not just shaping what the person will be called, but who that person will be. It is like those movies where the father has planned for the son to take over the family bakery, but the son does not want to be a baker. He wants to be a boxer. So he spends the whole movie tearing himself away from his father's story for his life, from the name his father had given him. This kind of naming oversteps the boundary line where one person ends and another begins. It is handing them a story and asking them to tell it as their own. CJ had a story from my life, and I started to believe that story was true. Childhood. My family lived in a small seaside town in New Jersey. Our neighborhood nudged right up to the edge of the water. We were the quintessential white, upper-middle-class American family. A father, a mother, two children, one boy and one girl, and a Siamese cat. My father worked for IBM. He'd come home from work in a gray pinstripe suit with a briefcase in his hand, changed into shorts and a t-shirt, and head out for his evening run before dinner. My father adored the water, and growing up, we usually owned a boat. In the summers, we rented a house for 2 weeks on Long Beach Island. I was too young to water ski then, but I can recall being bundled in my mother's lap, her arms wrapped around me tight, with the boat beating and scudding its way across the chop, wind whipping my hair across my face. My mother played tennis and I can picture her wearing a white tennis skirt and white tree-torn sneakers with a yellow logo. She wore those white ankle socks with the pom-poms on the back and a white sun visor, too. We'd ride up to the tennis courts, and while she played a match, I would spend the time running between the courts and a nearby beach. I reveled in the fact that I could run around freely, totally unsupervised. I wasn't. My brother Scott, 3 years older than me, was usually riding his bike around the neighborhood with his friends or getting ready for baseball. When I was 3, the Montessori teacher told my mother she was sure I would grow up to be a singer or an actress. She said that in her classroom of 30 children, my voice carried over everyone else's. Then she probably took 2 Tylenol. My mother thinks one of the reasons I am musical is because she was taking piano lessons while she was pregnant with me. Her teacher believed in teaching piano using real music only. So my mother learned the basics with Satie's Jamno Pari and Beethoven's Moonlight Sonata. Of course, she had me take piano lessons too. When I was 5, my parents took me into New York City to see the original production of Annie on Broadway, and I was never the same after that. I wanted to be Annie. I needed to be on that stage. I came home from New York and taught myself to sing with my record player and 3 vinyl albums. 2 of the albums were the musicals Annie and Oklahoma. The 3rd album was, ironically, a collection of feminist songs and stories my mother had given me, Free to Be You and Me. It featured a number of artists, Marlo Thomas, Alan Alda, Roberta Flack, and Michael Jackson, to name a few. The album sought to point a post-1960s America toward gender neutrality. The songs promoted values like individuality, tolerance, and comfort with one's own identity. The album most definitely shaped early thoughts I had about myself as a human being and as a woman, and gave me a framework for how I viewed the world. It also happened to be great for learning character acting. Cammie was my best friend in New Jersey. There was much to love about Cammie, but I especially loved that whenever we sang the duet between Daddy Warbucks and Annie, she always let me be Annie. We had it all choreographed, and I directed our rehearsals as if we had a performance coming up next week at the Met. Singing and dancing that song with her is one of my happiest childhood memories. Another friend of mine would come over, and we'd dress up in leotards and tutus and stand on the coffee table belting Kenny Rogers' The Gambler. I taught myself to sing out in the garage. The sound out there was amplified, and I felt electric as I listened to my own sound bouncing off the cement walls and floor all around me. I pressed and pushed my voice to discover what it could and couldn't do. I copied everything I heard, from the smallest inflection to a flare on a note to a particular tone or timbre. I felt my own power when I sang. At Girl Scout camp, I understood harmony for the first time. On the last night of camp, we were all circled around the flagpole after the flag ceremony. A couple of counselors broke out singing John Denver's Perhaps Love, and the tight harmonies they used caught my attention. I was mesmerized by the way their voices layered and intertwined over and under each other. The next day, on the 3-hour car ride home, I required my mother to sing the melody on repeat while I worked out the harmony part. In the 6th grade, the music director at the neighboring high school needed 6 munchkins for his production of The Wiz. When my teacher asked if anyone was interested in auditioning, my arm shot up. The day of the audition couldn't come soon enough for me. It was my first time on a real stage. While I was waiting for my turn, I looked down at the floor to distract myself and noticed the deep nicks and paint splatters everywhere. I wanted to know more about the stories held in those markings. When my name was called, I walked confidently to the designated place in the middle of the stage. I knew I could nail Annie any day of the week. The director, Mr. Crawford, was sitting high on a chair in the otherwise empty orchestra pit, about 15 feet away. A few people sat in the audience. I sang Tomorrow and became a munchkin. When I got to high school, Mr. Crawford told me he'd been waiting for me. He had developed the only performing arts program in the city, and half of my schedule was filled with music. He invested a great deal in me over the next 4 years and was upset when I didn't choose to go to music school. I'm not sure he ever forgave me. But I didn't want to sing opera. I wanted to go to Broadway. Mr. Crawford said I was too short for Broadway, and I was too scared to move to New York City alone at that time. Plus, in my family, it was an advancement of things past for a female to get a college degree. It was never a discussion that I might not go. So off to college I went. Family. My father has always had a strong, quiet presence about him. At 5'10" and muscular, my dad was handsome by anybody's standards. His childhood was a difficult one. His biological father, an elite fighter pilot, died during World War II when my father was just 6 weeks old. If you compare photographs of my dad and his father, they almost look like they could be the same person. The stress of it all caused my grandmother's milk to dry up, so she kept my dad alive with bananas. Mums is what I call her, though her name was Elise. I was always mesmerized by her. I call her the photographer-explorer grandmother because she took trips to exotic places like Africa, India, and the Galapagos Islands all by herself. By the time I knew her, she had remarried, and I thought it was bold of her to leave her husband behind. Mums was beautiful enough for Hollywood, slender and 5 feet tall with soft wavy hair and a slight Georgia accent. I can picture her standing just outside her kitchen door, taking a break from cooking, smoking a cigarette, and looking effortlessly chic in a drapey silk outfit or a pair of khakis and a white button shirt. Her home was as interesting as she was. Photographs of birds and other images from her travels, seashell collections labeled on glass displays, pine cone and nut wreaths she'd made, and stacks of yellow National Geographic magazines. I think Mums had a bit of a wild side to her, and I like to think she gave it to me. My own mother was playful, smart, athletic, and nurturing. But out of nowhere, she could also shock you with her pragmatic, no-nonsense attitude. As a young girl, she attended a strict all-girls Catholic school in Annapolis near her mother's job at the State House. My mother's father was a retired naval officer with a drinking problem, so it was her mother who provided stability and finances for the family. The highlight of my mother's side of the family was undoubtedly the crab feast held in the backyard of my grandmother's house on Kent Island. Every August, the entire family gathered there for a reunion. Long rows of picnic tables would be covered in old Baltimore Sun newspapers. Bushel baskets of crabs slathered in Old Bay seasoning were piled high in the center of each table. The whole yard buzzed with people, young, old, and everything in between. We'd spend hours hammering away, drinking beer or soda for the kids, and enjoying ourselves. We looked like a Norman Rockwell scene. For the most part, my parents chose to raise us without religion. Although my brother and I were baptized in the Episcopal Church as infants, that was as far as it went, really. My mother was determined not to raise us with the strict Catholic upbringing she had growing up, and my dad was more than happy to go along with that. He didn't want to repeat much of it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.